Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face covering should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 1089 in the name of Siobhan Brown on fetal alcohol spectrum disorders, Awareness Day, 9 September. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would first of all wish to ask those members who would seek to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Siobhan Brown to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms Brown. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to thank everyone who supported my motion to recognise International Fetal Alcohol Spectrum Disorder Awareness Day on the 9th of September and allowing for it to be debated in the Chamber today. Fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, commonly known as FASD, is a condition that deserves national attention and awareness. In my motion, I paid recognition to the work done by OSHA, an organisation within my constituency of Ayr, which provides support, advice, guidance for parents and carers of children who are affected by FASD. OSHA was founded by Mary Ellen and Billy McPhail. The McPhails have been fostering for over 20 years and have looked after more than 50 foster children during this time. Over the years, the McPhail family have been shocked to learn of the prevalence of FASD, particularly in children in care, and about the lack of resources for families and foster families affected. The story of the OSHA charity, however, is one that spreads hope, a hope of those with FASD that can lead a thriving and fulfilling life with the right support in place. Today, I want to tell you the story of Taylor, Mary Ellen and Billy's son. With an FASD diagnosis as a baby, which at the time was quite rare, as it only came about because the doctor noted the mother's alcohol dependence on the baby's medical notes, clinicians told the McPhails that Taylor would never walk, never talk, and never sit up. Taylor, supported by Mary Ellen and Billy, had other ideas and surpassed all these milestones. And to cut a long story short, he's now in mainstream education. Taylor proved in part to be the inspiration for the charity. When he was 9 years old, he wrote a book about an octopus called Osho. In the story, Osho the octopus was invited to a party but was worried that his tentacles would get stuck on the slide. But all his friends lent them their socks to wear, meaning that Osho could be just like everyone else and go down the slide and enjoy the party. I believe this story, written by Taylor, shows how we want Scotland to treat those like Osho. The answer is not to try and make the person fit in, but to make the surroundings fit the person, and then everyone can enjoy the metaphorical party. So, how common is FASD? It's estimated that around 4,500 people in Scotland have Down syndrome, about 44,000 have autism, around 37,000 have ADHD, and it's estimated that close to 285,000 people in Scotland could have FASD. We must look at ways on how we can reduce occurrences of FASD through education, raising awareness, and we can also offer resources and support to those already affected. Similarly, to the fantastic work that's been done in Scotland to make Scotland more autism-friendly, I'd urge the Scottish Government to implement an FASD strategy to address prevention, diagnosis and support and engagement for awareness and training across all sectors, public health, medical, education, social work, criminal justice, third sector and housing. Today I want to highlight diagnosis, support and prevention. You will already know that FASD is caused by exposure to alcohol in the womb. Without a fully developed liver, the fetus is unable to filter out the toxins which are passed freely through the placenta into the bloodstream. One in seven babies experience significant alcohol exposure in Scotland. However, this is what's not commonly known, is that there is a suggestion that 99% of fetal alcohol spectrum disorder cases are left undiagnosed. People with FASD experience problems with thinking, speech, social skills, timekeeping, and memory. The condition often exists alongside autism, ADHD, and mental health problems. But it's not just a brain issue. It can also affect facial features, limbs, and height. All these together mean the condition requires sophisticated diagnosis and treatment, with research showing an early diagnosis can make a massive difference. A 2017 study on doctors across the UK found that only 31% of the GPs said they had an in-depth education regarding FASD. It is very welcome that the Scottish Government has been funding the Fetal Alcohol Advisory and Support Team since 2015. The small team based in Ayrshire has become the national hub for providing training, research and consultations on FASD. They offer assessments for children and provide support and mediation in schools for parents and carers. FASD usually comes with overlapping social issues. 50% of individuals end up in prison, psychiatric hospitals, or drug treatment facilities. An FASD diagnosis is 28 times higher in these settings than in the general population. Those with FASD are more likely to experience homelessness, unemployment and dependent living, with such experiences leaving them to face additional issues like addiction. 35% have drug and alcohol problems, 23% have received inpatient care for mental illness. When looking at ways to support those with FASD, we must look at a multi-strand plan of action. That means looking at poverty, domestic violence, mental health and safe and secure housing, just to name a few. The Scottish Government has taken considerable action to raise awareness of the dangers of drinking while pregnant and to train health practitioners on how to educate women. Since 2016, we've also increased screening of alcohol intake while pregnant, with midwives encouraged to record instances of alcohol on the mother's health records. However, I'm led to believe that in many cases, it is not recorded on the baby's medical record. This is key to ensure that the correct diagnosis of FASD, especially within the care system, and that means being on the child's record, not only just the mother's. 80% of children in care have FASD, and it can be easy for society to demonise biological mothers. When pregnant, it's important the mother feels that she could be honest about her alcohol use. If it's an addiction, it's not easy to stop. We must remove the stigma for those seeking help. We must educate society on the dangers of alcohol to an unborn baby, the ones we know about and the ones we're hearing about today. We must inform mums-to-be. We must treat people with compassion, but most we need to recognise that the support and help these children need and young people and adults with FASD need. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Brown. And I now would call on members who have pressed their button to speak. And I first call CoCab Stewart up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you. Firstly, I'd like to thank my colleague, Siobhan Brown, for leading this debate. And I would also like to extend my gratitude to the work carried out by Alcohol Focus Scotland for providing ongoing information and support to all those affected by fetal alcohol spectrum disorder. As a country, our relationship with alcohol is fractious and troubled at times, and tackling harmful patterns of consumption undoubtedly represent one of the most significant public health challenges that we face today. It can be difficult and a sensitive issue to address, considering that we all know people whose lives, families and communities that have been impacted by the effects of harmful alcohol use. Yet, despite this awareness, fetal alcohol spectrum disorder is often described simultaneously as the most prevalent and the most invisible neurodevelopmental condition in Scotland. Often misunderstood and misdiagnosed, the effects of FASD are diverse and can lead to a wide range of both mental and physical issues, including a reduced capacity for learning and understanding behaviours. As a teacher, I have witnessed firsthand the limiting nature of FASD. For children affected by this condition, the already intimidating school environment can be incredibly difficult to navigate. developmental problems with social skills and communication, and the requirement for additional educational support sadly place these students at a greater risk of exclusion and bullying, an experience which they will likely carry for the rest of their lives. In addition, the limited knowledge and expertise of teachers at times in managing and accommodating children with FASD represents a further obstacle in their efforts to create a constructive and inclusive learning environment. Thankfully, we are here to remind and inform people FASD is preventable. It is crucial that we promote recognition of the dangers attributed to drinking alcohol during any stage of pregnancy, and that we do so in a way which does not seek to penalise or condemn women. Our focus should remain firmly on education and health of the population of all, while taking care not to stigmatise FASD, which would only deter individuals from seeking the help and treatment that they need. I am therefore pleased to see that the Scottish Government has remained committed to its 2018 pledge to increase support for children and families affected. Since 2018, amidst the provision of over £395,000 in funding to the Fetal Alcohol Advisory and Support Team, this government has launched a successful FASD hub. Through this hub, essential tiered support services and vital lifelines are offered to members of the public. I'd also like to highlight the creation of a free FASD learning resource on the NHS Education for Scotland website, which includes valuable guidance for educators, as well as helpful resources for parents and carers. Going forward, I hope that we can continue to promote and increase awareness so that no child is born avoidably suffering the consequences. I firmly believe that by championing campaigns such as #NoAlcoholNoRisk and supporting the sustained development and expansion of services designed to help families across Scotland, we can improve the physical and mental well-being of our children and provide them with the high quality of life that they deserve. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Megan Gallagher to be followed by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I commend Siobhan Brown for bringing this important issue to the Chamber today. As we've heard, fetal alcohol spectrum disorders can cause children to have a range of issues that are a direct result from alcohol consumption during pregnancy. We must continue to raise awareness of this condition to ensure that mothers understand the dangers of drinking whilst pregnant and the impact this can have on their unborn child. FASD was not something I was aware of until I was in my mid-20s, and for me, education is one of the best ways for people to learn about having a happy, healthy pregnancy. Given that 3 in every 100 babies in the UK are affected by this condition and that roughly 45% of pregnancies are unplanned, educating young people might be one way to reduce the number of children being born with this condition. Another, and I know we don't have enough time to discuss this in more depth today, is to continue to tackle the issues we have in Scotland in relation to binge drinking. We also know that the issues relating to binge drinking have only been exacerbated by the COVID-19 pandemic, causing real concern to health boards, experts and organisations which offer advice regarding FASD. Whilst FASD is completely preventable, Alcohol Focus Scotland and other organisations have suggested it is a cause for concern, as no amount of alcohol is safe for pregnant women or women planning for a pregnancy. Turning to children and adults with FASD, I agree with Siobhan Brown and others that we must do more to support them. Whilst there are a wide range of benefits and support networks to help families with this condition, as FASD goes undetected for quite some time, it means that many try to cope without talking to organisations who could assist them. Again, turning to my earlier point of education, if teachers and childcare professionals were trained to spot the symptoms of FASD, this may allow families to understand what support is available to them. During Ms Brown's opening contribution, she spoke passionately about the area she represents and the excellent work being carried out by O'Shea's FASD organisation based in Ayr, and also the wonderful story she told about Taylor and O'Shea the Octopus, which really gives us an insight about people living with FASD, and it's why it's so important that we must continue to talk about this condition. Therefore, I would like to continue with that narrative by talking about the work carried out by NHS Lanarkshire on the run-up to FASD Awareness Day, which took place on the 9th of September. As part of their campaign, NHS Lanarkshire released figures conducted by Alcohol Focus Scotland, which revealed around 29% of adults were drinking more than before COVID-19 restrictions were introduced. In addition, younger adults were more likely to report an increase in frequency and quantity of alcohol consumed. NHS Lanarkshire took to social media to raise awareness, but also target those who were more likely to become pregnant or who were trying to conceive, providing details of who they can contact for support. Although this campaign was positively received, again, more work needs to be done to make this neurodevelopmental condition more known. Various groups, including Alcohol Focus Scotland, have called on the Scottish Government to introduce mandatory alcohol labelling to increase awareness of the risks associated with drinking. Most of the labelling on bottles are not satisfactory at present, with many being a small picture with no information or explanation of why you should not drink whilst pregnant. Alcohol Focus Scotland argue that providing helpful messaging on labels will provide information and advice at the point of purchase, which will help women make a choice which is healthy for their unborn child. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I would once again like to thank Siobhan Brown for bringing this issue to the Chamber today, and hopefully by raising awareness, more can be done to support pregnant women and families living with FASD. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Paul O'Kane to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also thank Siobhan Brown for bringing this important debate to the Chamber today as we mark International FASD Awareness Day, which, as we've heard already, fell on the 9th of September. I think it is vitally important that as a Parliament we have an opportunity to talk about this issue, to raise awareness and to call for continued action to support interventions to reduce the prevalence and impact of FASD in Scotland and indeed to support those living with it. I would like to thank, as colleagues have done, Alcohol Focus Scotland for their informative briefing ahead of today's debate and indeed for their continued work to raise awareness and campaign for solutions. As we've heard already, it has been estimated that around 3.2% of Scotland's young people are living with FASD, and as Siobhan Brown said, when we compare that to other conditions such as autism, it is quite stark. Indeed, a study in my region, West Scotland, suggests that prevalence is higher than previously thought, with as many as 40% of babies showing signs of exposure to alcohol in the second trimester, and 1 in 7 showing signs of exposure to high and frequent consumption. FASD affects people throughout their lives. 90% experience mental health problems, 79% experience unemployment, 60% have disrupted school experiences, 43% have their education disrupted, 35% have been imprisoned as adolescents, and 23% have needed inpatient psychiatric care. And life expectancy for people with FASD is tragically short at just 34 years, with many deaths attributed to addiction, misadventure, or suicide. Those figures are stark, and really, I think they point to the need for renewed action, which is incumbent upon all of us. Actions such as the calls by Alcohol Focus Scotland and others to move to a mandatory system of labelling on alcohol, which Megan Gallagher alluded to in her remarks. Those warnings have to be clear on the risks, particularly during pregnancy. Because we know that over a quarter, 28% of women in the UK are unaware of the current health advice from chief medical officers, which makes clear that there is no safe amount of alcohol to consume during pregnancy. And it's clear that more must be done to compel alcohol companies to label products appropriately, making clear risks with health information and advice at the point of purchase. And it's of course important that we do not demonise women or stigmatise FASD, as CoCab Stewart alluded to. Interventions such as labelling must sit alongside better community supports and education, particularly during pregnancy. We know the difference that a strong, supportive relationship with a trusted professional can make, And I want to acknowledge the work of GPs, nurses, midwives and social workers in this area. And I do hope and I know that the Minister will pick up on some of those areas in closing. So as I begin to draw my remarks to a close, I would like to call for better support for those living with FASD, particularly young care experienced people, because we know the challenges that are particularly experienced by that group. As we seek to keep the promise, which we all want to do, we must deliver. Adoption UK, through their FASD hub in Scotland, have made clear the need for diagnosis and support to be improved, sitting alongside that work in prevention. Particular calls include a published FASD-specific strategy to cover awareness raising, diagnosis and support services, individual plans and lifelong support for all children diagnosed with FASD, including home, educational, mental health and access to work support and resources, and individuals who have a diagnosis of FASD to be given a multidisciplinary support plan, acknowledging their individual needs and that of their parents, carers and wider family. And that should include access to relevant and required support services. Deputy Presiding Officer, we must continue to raise awareness of FASD and do all that we can to support prevention, diagnosis and support in order to save and improve lives. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Rona Mackay, who will be followed by Brian Whittle. Brian Whittle will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to wind up the debate. Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, can I thank my colleague Siobhan Brown for bringing this important debate to the Chamber to recognise International FASD Awareness Day and for highlighting the great work being done in her constituency. My pleasure to speak in this debate. As Siobhan said, an estimated 285,000 children and young people and adults throughout Scotland could have fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, a lifelong, life-changing neurodevelopmental condition. And yet, amazingly, less than 1% of them have ever been formally diagnosed and properly supported. Even more startling is the reality that FASD is preventable, but sadly, it's not so often prevented. Presiding Officer, around 7 years ago, I was a children's panel member in the East End of Glasgow. I was fortunate to attend a lecture by, I think, Dr. Jonathan Sher of the Queen's Nursing Institute of Scotland, whose knowledge on this subject is beyond compare. Apologies if I've confused him with someone else, but I'm pretty sure it was Dr. Sher. He told panel members that many of the children referred to us would be suffering from FASD. In effect, much of their behaviour and many of their issues related to having this condition, but many were often undiagnosed. This made immediate sense to me, and it shone a light on many of the young people we saw and the day-to-day difficulties they faced due to being exposed to alcohol in the womb. I also remember he spoke about advice given to pregnant women at that time about limiting their alcohol intake. He said the only way to be sure your child would not be affected by FASD was to avoid drinking entirely, as the body processes alcohol differently in every person. He pointed out that what might have low impact on one person could be devastating to another. His message, the only way to avoid giving your baby FASD was to drink no alcohol at all. Presiding Officer, in Scotland we want to give every child the best start in life and our policies reflect that. However, some children are denied getting that best start before they're even born. FASD is a family of complex conditions arising from exposure to alcohol at any stage of pregnancy. It affects the child's physical and mental health, capacity to learn, and it is the most common but unrecognised neurodevelopmental condition in Scotland. It can cause learning disabilities, speech and language difficulties, and many other issues which we've heard members outline today. Early diagnosis and support for people with FASD is crucial to avoid a range of issues they commonly encounter. In later life, 90% of those affected are estimated to experience mental health problems. A large number experience unemployment, imprisonment. Many need inpatient psychiatric care. Last November, the Scottish Government and NHS Education Scotland launched an excellent e-learning resource on FASD, accessible to anyone, which explains what FASD is, how to prevent it, and the support available. In 2017, Adoption UK conducted a survey of nearly 3,000 adopters looking at a range of issues. 70% of respondents said they weren't warned that their child could be at risk of FASD when they adopted. Furthermore, 85% have not been told since they adopted that their child may have FASD, and 35% have considered that their child might have FASD. They report that 55% of children waited 2 years or longer for their FASD diagnosis, and 78% of parents whose children were diagnosed with FASD didn't feel that healthcare professionals were knowledgeable about the condition or its various presentations. So, as we've heard other members say, they recommend improved diagnosis and support for people living with FASD through the introduction of a dedicated multi-year national strategy for treatment and prevention. That combined with increased awareness of the risks associated with drinking during pregnancy. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, FASD is a condition that's entirely presentable. It's not about stigmatising or shaming women. It just requires women not to drink for the entirety of their pregnancy. And what we're facing today, with the scourge of a global pandemic still prevalent, surely that's not too much to ask to ensure that our children do get the best start in life. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call Brian Whittle.
Thank you. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you for letting me sneak into this debate at the last minute. Can I thank Siobhan Brown for bringing this really important debate to the Chamber? She highlights the impact of a diagnosis of FASD can have on a person, that increased likelihood of custodial sentences. Early death, as Paul Kane talked about, homelessness, unemployment, and the higher level of mental illness. I have a really personal interest in this because I was approached by a couple of foster parents to work with their adopted son and daughter, both who have a diagnosis of FASD. And what I wanted to discuss, one that I have such fondness for these parents and respect for what they do in taking on children and with this condition. And what I wanted to do is that, in a positive way, is talk about the impact of giving opportunity to children with this condition to participate and the benefits of sport. Now, you knew I was going to get sport in here somewhere, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I've worked with this young man for several years, and he is nothing but a ball of fast-twitch fibres. And his outlet for his fast-twitch fibres happens to be sport. And I think the point there is if he didn't have that outlet, where would that energy go? If you met this young man, you would say he was very active. He's a very energetic, he laughs a lot, he smiles a lot, but he has an outlet. And I think the benefit of that sport brings to self-discipline, the structure that brings to his life, I think is immense. He has become an international athlete himself. He has had the opportunity to travel, and that in itself has helped him develop as an individual. And he's at college at the moment. He's now studying at college. And I think that in itself tells a story. I think it's very similar to the story that Siobhan Brown made. What I would say, though, is that COVID has had a specific impact on people with this kind of condition. Because when that structure and that sort of discipline structure and support is unavailable, when I was managing to get my athletes back to see them, the impact on him was much more marked than it had been on the rest of the squad. I have to say that he obviously had a love of donuts, I think is probably the way I would like to put that. And I think that's something that we do need to consider when as I say, I'm a big believer, as you know, in giving kids the opportunity to participate in it. It doesn't have to be sport. It could be music, art, drama, whatever. But the impact that COVID has had on the vulnerable and they haven't been able to access that. So the system needs to consider, I think, also how support is maintained from a child into adult in a foster situation, because the support drops off dramatically once they get to a certain age. I think FASD is a preventable condition. I think, as Siobhan Brown has said and others have said, we need to look at how we prevent this happening in the first instance. It is a health issue. We do need to consider Scotland has an unhealthy relationship with alcohol, and I think that's where we need to start, Deputy Presiding Officer. With that, once again, I'll thank Siobhan Brown for bringing this debate to the Chamber, and for yourself, Deputy Presiding Officer, for letting me sneak in. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Whitto. And I now call on Kevin Stewart to wind up for the Scottish Government. Up to about 7 minutes, please, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And first of all, I pay tribute to Siobhan Brown for bringing this motion to the Chamber. And I'd like to thank every single member for their consensual approach to this debate and on this extremely important issue. I would also like to pay tribute to the MacPhails and their work that Ms Brown has described today. And Taylor's book, Oshie the Octopus, will now definitely have to be on my reading list. And maybe Ms Brown can help me source a copy of that. Fetal alcohol spectrum disorder, or FASD, which is caused, as others have said, by prenatal alcohol exposure, is one of the most common neurodevelopmental conditions in Scotland. But it is also one of the lesser known ones. And it's in respect of those simple facts that I find myself wholeheartedly in agreement with today's motion. We must all do more to promote the dangers of alcohol consumption during pregnancy, but also to support those with a diagnosis of FASD. We all must do our level best to destigmatise the situation that some of the folks who have alcohol problems have in getting them to the right help. And we should also be supportive of the pregnant woman in our lives, whether we be partners, family members, friends, in all of this. There is no safe amount of alcohol which can be consumed during pregnancy. The advice from Scotland's Chief Medical Officer is clear. No alcohol, no risk. And the government is taking forward a range of work to help support this message. Our 2018 alcohol framework demonstrates that we are committed to improved health messaging on alcohol. And we have committed to press alcohol producers to put health information on physical product and packaging labels. And we will be prepared to consider taking a mandatory approach in Scotland if progress is not made. And this action will include consideration of pregnancy warning labels. Positive progress is, however, being made as alcohol consumption in Scotland in 2020 remained at its lowest level since 1994. Reduced levels of alcohol consumption across society can lead to a reduced prevalence of FASD. Prevention and early intervention remain vital in respect of reducing the impact of FASD. However, it is also vital that children and young people with a diagnosis can access the right support in terms of both health and social care, or even sport, as Mr. Whittle has mentioned in his speech. To best ensure support to those impacted by FASD, we have funded the Fetal Alcohol Advisory and Support Team since 2018 to deliver training nationally. This improves the knowledge of professionals working with individuals with FASD, and we've also funded the Royal College of General Practitioners to produce an e-learning module on FASD for GPs and the wider healthcare community in primary care. Furthermore, we provided Adoption UK Scotland with over £526,000 since June of 2019 to establish FASD Hub Scotland. And the Hub provides a foundation upon which awareness of FASD can be further promoted. And it also provides a dedicated helpline and support and advice to parents, carers and children who have been impacted by FASD. It is notable that on FASD Awareness Day earlier this month, Adoption UK called on governments across the UK to replicate the success of FASD Hub Scotland. And in addition to our FASD specific offerings, the Scottish Government has also published principles and standards of care through a new national neurodevelopmental specification for children and young people. And the new specification aims to ensure
that children with neurodevelopmental profiles, including those with FASD, receive further support than is currently available. This offering will sit alongside the Child and Adolescent Mental Health Service, CAMHS, and this work will benefit from the recently announced £10.83 million funding to support service provision through Phase 2 of our Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund. Specifically, £5.25 million of this funding is being allocated to NHS boards to build professional capacity to support children and young people with neurodevelopmental support needs. And furthermore, we are at an early stage and are putting resources in place to allow us to start consulting on what people would like to see from the wider Autism, Learning Disabilities and Neurodiversity Bill, which we committed to in the latest programme for government, with part of this being the creation of a commissioner. The bill has arisen from discussions around autism and learning disabilities in particular, but consultation on the bill will include other neurodevelopmental support issues like FASD. As with every piece of proposed legislation, working with individuals with lived experience and organisations will be at its heart, and I would encourage all interested parties to get involved in those discussions when we begin them early next year. Our proposal to develop a national care service also provides significant potential to better ensure that those impacted by FASD can access the social care support that they need and deserve. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I'd like to record my thanks for the opportunity to take part in this debate and for the thoughtful contributions of all colleagues across this Parliament in their contributions today. While FASD remains a significant lifelong condition affecting an individual's mental and physical health, it remains preventable, and early diagnosis and tailored interventions can improve outcomes for children. In Scotland, we have a solid foundation on which to build our level of support in respect of FASD through work with OSHAs and other organisations like them. The Government remains committed to continuing to take forward this important area of work. Finally, Presiding Officer, I would like to thank Ms Brown once again for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting until 2:30.